Gather round, fellas, I'll tell you some tales about murder and blueberry pies and heroes and hells and bottomless wells and lullabies, legends and lies. And gather round, ladies, come sit at my feet. I'll sing about warm, sunny skies. There's mermaids and beams and loving machines in my lullabies, legends and lies. Lullabies, legends and lies and lies. Lullabies, legends and lies. I'll sing song, then I'll shuffle along with my lullabies, legends, and lies. I may make you wonder, I may make you smile, I may bring the tears to your eyes, but when I disappear, Lord, you wish I was here. Lullabies, legends, and lies. So open the bottle and pass a guitar and look in my warm, loving eyes. I'll take you to places you ain't been before with my lullabies, legends, and lies.
You know, American folklore is filled with legendary characters like Billy the Kid, Johnny Appleseed, Pecos Bill, and probably the greatest one of all has got to be Paul Bunyan, because he was the meanest and the biggest and the dirtiest and the tobacco chewingest and the funkiest and the best wood chopper of all of them. Well, he rode through the woods on a big blue ox. He had fists as hard as chopping blocks, 500 pounds and 9 feet tall. Now that's Paul. Talk about working. When he swings his axe, you could hear it ring for a mile and a half. Then he'd yell timber and down she'd fall for Paul. Talk about drinking, that man so mean that he'd never drink nothing but kerosene. A 5-gallon can is a little bit small for Paul. Talk about women, that man so lusty needs a woman every hour just to keep him getting rusty. The young ones run and the old ones crawl to Paul. Talk about tough, well, he once had a fight with a thunderstorm on a cold, dark night. I ain't saying who won, but it don't storm at all around here, thanks to Paul. He was 90 years old when he said with a sigh, I said, I think I'm gonna lay right down and die. Cause sunshine and sorrow, I seen it all, says Paul. Says there ain't no man alive can kill me, ain't no woman left can
think a heaven just might be a ball that says Paul. So he died and we cried. It took 18 men just to bust the ground. Took 3 or 4 more just to lower him down. And we covered him up and we figured that was all for Paul. But late one night, the tree started shaking, and the dog started barking, and the earth started quaking, and out of the ground with a hi-yaw came Paul. Well, he shook the dirt from my office clothes, he scratched his ass and wiped his nose. You know, being dead wasn't no fun at all, says Paul. He said, now up in heaven they got harps on their knees, they got clouds and wings, but they got no trees. I don't think that's much of a heaven at all, says Paul. So he jumps on his ox for the farewell. He said, I'll find out if they got trees in hell. He rode away. That was all we ever seen Paul. But the next time you hear a timber yell that sounds like it's coming from the pits of hell, then a booming laugh and a ghostly wail like somebody chopping on the devil's tail, then a shout and a call, a crash and a fall, that ain't no mortal man at all, that's just Paul.
The most famous of all the voodoo queens that ever existed is Marie Laveau down in Louisiana. There's a lot of weird, ungodly tales about Marie. She's supposed to have a lot of magic potions and spells and curses.
Down in Louisiana where the black trees grow lives a voodoo lady named Marie Laveau. She got a black cat tooth and a mojo bone. Swamp in a hollow log with a one-eyed snake and a three-legged dog. She got a bent, bony body and stringy hair. And if she ever seen y'all messing around there, she go, another man done gone. And then one night when the moon was black, into the swamp come Handsome Jack. No good man like you all know. When he was looking around for Marie Laveau, he said, Marie Laveau, you lovely witch, now give me a little charm that'll make me rich. Now give me $1,000,000 and tell you what I'll do. This very night I'm gonna marry you, and it'll be another man done gone. So Marie done some magic and she shook a little sand and made $1,000,000 and she put it in his hand. Then she giggled and she wiggled and she said, hey, hey, I'm getting ready for my wedding day. But oh, a handsome Jack, he said, goodbye, Marie. You're too damn ugly for a rich man like me. Then Marie started mumbling, her fangs started gnashing, her body started trembling, and her eyes started flashing, and she went, another man done gone. Oh, if you ever get down where the black trees grow and meet a voodoo lady named Marie Laveau, if she ever asks you to make her your wife, man, you better stay with her for the rest of your life, or it'll be another man done gone.
Because I'd like to introduce you to the next superstar. 20 years from now, he's going to be so ashamed of what he has done on this record that he's probably going to sue me. And he and all of his friends are going to be sitting around stone. He said, look what the old man made me do. Let's give a big round of applause to Bobby Barrett Jr.
Daddy, what if the sun stopped shining? What would happen then?
If the sun stopped shining, you'd be so surprised. You'd stare at the heavens with wide open eyes. And the wind would carry your light to the skies. And the sun would start shining again. Stop blowing, then the land would be dry, and your boat wouldn't sail, and son, your kite couldn't fly, and the grass would see your trouble. She'd tell the wind, and the wind would start blowing again. If the grass stopped growing, you'd probably cry. And the ground would be watered by the tears from your eyes. And like your love for me, that grass would grow so high. This grass would start growing again.
But Daddy, what if I stopped loving you? What would happen then?
If you stop loving me, then the grass would stop growing, the sun would stop shining, and the wind would stop blowing. So you see, if you want to keep this old world going, you better start loving me again, again. Better start loving me again. You hear me, Bob? You better start loving me again. You love me, Bobby.
Yeah.
You better start loving me. I swear you could taste the chicken and tomatoes, the noodles and the marrow bone. But it really wasn't nothing but some water and potatoes and the wonderful, wonderful soup stone. Hanging from a string in my mama's kitchen back in the hard time days was a little old stone about the size of an apple. It was smooth and worn and gray. There wasn't much food in my mama's kitchen, so whenever things got tight, mama'd boil up some water, put in the stone, say, let's have some soup tonight. And I swear you could taste the chicken and tomatoes and the noodles and the marrow bone. But it really wasn't nothing but some water and potatoes and the wonderful, wonderful soup stone. It had been in the family for a whole lot of years, so we knew it was a nourishing thing. And I remember Mama as she stirred it in the water, and we could all hear her sing. Hey, it's a magical stone, and as long as we got it, we'll never have a hungry night. Just add a little love to the wonderful soup stone, and everything will be all right.
And I swear we could taste the chicken and tomatoes and the noodles and the marrow bone. But it really wasn't nothing but some water and potatoes and the wonderful, wonderful soup stone. So it carried us all through the darkening days till finally the sunshine came. And the soup stone started in a gathering dust, but it hung there just the same. Ever since then, Lord, the food's been plenty, but every now and then I find that Mama in the kitchen and the wonderful soup stone drifts across my mind. And again I taste the chicken and the tomatoes and the noodles and the marrow bone. But it really wasn't nothing but some water and potatoes and a wonderful, wonderful soup stone. We were nourished by the wonderful soup stone. Oh, the wonderful, wonderful soup stone.
Like a drunk old fool, and I knew if I hit him right, why I could knock him off of that stool. But everybody, they said, watch out, hey, that's Tiger Man McCool. He's had a whole lot of fights, and he's always come out winner. Yeah, he's a winner. But I'd had myself about five too many, and I walked up tall and proud. I faced his back, and I faced the fact that he had never stooped or bowed. I said, Tiger Man, you're a pussycat, and a hush fell on the crowd. I said, let's you and me go outside and see who's a winner. Well, he gripped the bar with one big hairy hand and embraced against the wall. He slowly looked up from his beer, and my God, that man was tall. He said, boy, I see you're a scrapper, so just before you fall, I'm gonna tell you just a little about what it means to be a winner. He said, now you see these bright white smiling teeth, you know they ain't my own. Mine rolled away like chiclets down a street in San Antonio. But I left that person cursing, nursing seven broken bones, and he only broke three of mine. That makes me the winner. He said, now behind this grin, I got a steel pin that holds my jaw in place. A trophy of my most successful motorcycle race. And each morning when I wake and touch this scar across my face, it reminds me of all I got by being a winner. Now this broken back was a dying act of a handsome hairy clay. That sticky Cincinnati night I stole his wife away. But that woman, she gets uglier and she gets meaner every day. But I got her, boy, and that's what makes me a winner. He said, you gotta speak loud when you challenge me, son, 'cause it's hard for me to hear with this twisted neck and these migraine pains and this big old cauliflower ear. And if it wasn't for this glass eye of mine, why, I'd shed a happy tear to think of all that you're gonna get by being a winner. I got arthritic elbows, boy. I got dislocated knees from picking fights with thunderstorms and charging into trees. And my nose been broke so often, I might lose it if I sneeze. And son, you say you still wanna be a winner. Now you remind me a lot of my younger days with your knuckles a-quenching white. But boy, I'm gonna sit right here and sip this beer all night. And if there's something that you gotta gain or prove by winning some silly fight, well, okay, I quit. I lose, you're the winner. So I stumbled from that barroom, not so tall and not so proud. And behind me I still hear the hoots and laughter of the crowd. But my eyes still see and my nose still works and my teeth are still in my mouth. And you know, I guess that makes me the winner!
You know, everything that's ever been written about the Civil War, they wrote about brother fighting brother and father fighting son, and nobody has ever really written a song about the ones that stayed behind, you know, like the women that lost their men. And that's what this is about.
Have you seen Amanda Blaine in the hills of Shiloh, wandering through the morning rain in the hills of Shiloh? Have you seen her at her door, listening for the cannon roar, and a man who went to war from the hills of Shiloh? Have you heard her mournful cry? Have you seen her haunted eyes in the hills of Shiloh? Have you seen her running down, searching through the sleepy town, and her yellow seen her standing there in the hills of Shiloh, wind a blowing through her hair in the hills of Shiloh, listening for the sound of guns, listening for the rolling drums, and a man who never comes to the hills of Shiloh. Have you heard Amanda sing in the hills of Shiloh, whispering to her wedding ring in the hills of Shiloh?
40 years ago in the hills of
Took in by a girl with a twinkly eye. But the first time that I wasn't looking, she run off with a handsomer guy. Oh my, but I'm an inventing type feller, so as soon as my brain got uncurled, I tiptoed right down to my cellar and built a mechanical girl. All her arms are iron, her legs are steel, her hips are on wires attached to a wheel, and her spine is a coil that I now and then oil. She's my ever-loving machine. She's always right there when I need her, and she's very easy to please, and hardly costs nothing to feed her, just some water and oil and grease. She never complains when I stay out all night. She never complains that I ain't rich. And each time I want her just to cuddle me up tight, I just reach out and turn on her switch. All her arms are iron, her legs are steel, her hips are on wires attached to a wheel, and her spine is a coil that I now end in oil. She's my making her mind up, 'cause friends, I did not give her a mind. And her heart is a clock that I wind up, so I know that she'll love me in time. She always did what she was supposed to, right up to this evening. But then she had an affair with the toaster, and they run off and left me again. Oh, her arms were iron, her legs were steel, her hips were wired, attached to a wheel, and her spine.
When I was 12 years old, you see the pictures of mermaids in all the books and magazines. Not mermaids, mermaids. That's what we called them up home. And all the pictures, yeah, they never had no bras on. They didn't have anything on. And I was old enough that I knew that they really didn't exist, but I also wondered if they did exist, then what the hell would you do with one if you caught it?
When I was a lad in a fishing town, an old man said to me, you can spend your life, your jolly life, just sailing on the sea. You can search the world for pretty girls till your eyes are weak and dim, but don't go swimming with a mermaid, son, if you don't know how to swim. 'Cause her hair is green as seaweed and her skin is blue and pale, and I tell you now before you start, you can love that girl with all your heart, but you're just gonna love the upper part, you're not gonna like the tail. So I signed on to a whaling ship, and my very first day at sea, I seen a mermaid in the waves reaching out to me. Come live with me in the sea, said she, and down on the ocean's floor, I'll show you a million wondrous things you never seen before. So I jumped and she pulled me down, down to her seaweed bed, and a pillow made of tortoise shells she placed beneath my head. She fed me shrimps and caviar upon a silver dish. From her head to her waist, she was just my taste, but the rest of her was a fish. Her hair was green as seaweed, and her skin was blue and pale, and her face, it was a work of art, and I loved that girl with all my heart, but only loved the upper part. I did not like the tail. Then one day she swam away and I sang to the clams and whales. I missed her fins and her seaweed hair and the silvery shine of her scales. Then her sister, she swam by and set my heart awhirl, 'cause her upper part was an ugly fish, but the bottom part was a girl. Yeah, her toes are pink and rosy, and her knees are smooth and pale, and her legs, they are a work of art, and I love that girl with all my heart. I don't give a damn about the upper part, and that's how I end my tale.
All right. Here's Frank.
There was a time in the days of our glorious West when a sun-baked cowboy would come riding his horse into town, and he'd be sweating and tired, and he never did get a good welcome, especially from the sheriff. That cowboy was a hero to nobody but kids and girls. For a while, it looked like the modern-day cowboy was gonna be the truck drivers, but the damn trucks kept getting bigger, and the runs kept getting longer, and the union moved in, and I guess the modern-day cowboy would have to be what we call the motorcycle rider. Does anyone know of a girl who might like a tired old boy on a rusty old bike who just pulled in today from the Florida Glades? Just got to stop and rest a while, and rest a while. Does anyone know of someone who can use a hard-working fool who don't never touch booze, and whose only vice is the roll of the dice, and he's just got to stop, rest a while, and rest a while. Easy there, lady, I don't want no trouble. I'll pay for my chili and leave. Easy there, mister, I got the money, and if I was you, I'd let go of my sleeve. Does anyone know of a place I can sleep where I won't hear the cry of the wind
hand as she weeps for a poor wandering soul who got no place to go and just got to stop and rest a while and rest a while. Oh, fellas, you can't have a ride 'cause my bike and my girls I don't share. Hey, Sheriff, thank you for stopping and being concerned about the length of my hair. Can anyone lend me a half tank of gas? And I guess that a smile would be too much to ask, 'cause your warm, friendly town don't want my kind around. And I guess I can't stop and rest a while and rest a while. Hello, Mama, your boy's coming home 'cause my bike and my dreams all got wrecked. No, Mama, don't hang up the phone. I'm sorry that I had to call you, Colette. Guess that a smile would be too much to ask. Your warm, friendly town don't want my kind around. I guess I won't stop and rest a while. And rest a while. They say there he sits in his big white wicker rocker, eating candy-coated cashews, sipping orange lemonade, while a sweet young thing fans the flies from off his eyebrows. He's dozing in the green catalpa shade. Lord, they say that Jesse Langtry's got it made. Little bit south of the Okeechobee, there's a story that the swamp folks tell about a mean old man named Jesse Langtry and a sweet young maid and a bottomless well that water's cold. But that don't matter how deep it is, no one can tell. Just drop a stone, you never hear it splatter. It just falls down, down forever in the bottomless well. Through 15 miles of snakes and gators, with a raging fever and a trembling chill, I wandered lost through the Okeechobee. And there I seen him sitting there by the bottomless well. Yeah, now there he sat in his big white wicker rocker, eating his candy-coated cashews, sipping orange lemonade, while that sweet young thing fanned the flies from off his eyebrows. He's dozing in the green catalpa shade. Lord, I swear that Jesse Langtry got it made.
Oh, let's hear it for Jesse now.
I asked her for a drink of water, and as Jesse slept, me and her, we talked a spell. She said that she was his wife and daughter, Lord, Lord. But his heart was cold, cold and dark as a bottomless well. And as he slept, I bent to kiss her. I heard a loud and jealous yell. Felt my head explode in darkness. Two big hairy arms picked me up and dragged me to the bottomless well. I woke up in fear and trembling. I was staring down into the jaws of hell. As he held me high above his shoulders, they're gonna throw me down, down, down to the bottomless well. Now here I sit in Jesse's big white wicker rocker, eating his candy-coated cashews, sipping his orange lemonade, while that sweet young thing fans the flies from off my brows. I'm dozing in the green catawba shade, enjoying things that Jesse Langtree made. Oh, God bless you, Jesse. Now some folks say that sweet thing pushed him, but I was there and I swear he fell. But it ain't murder, 'cause he ain't dead, 'cause he's still a-falling. Going down, down forever in the bottomless well. Going down, 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 down. Bye, Jesse. This morning I jumped on my horse and went out for a ride. Some wild outlaws chased me and they shot me in the side. So I crawled into a wildcat's cave to find a place to hide. But some pirates found me asleep in there and soon they had me tied. Till a lady zombie cut me loose and begged to be my bride. So I said I'd come back Wednesday, but I must admit I lied. 'Cause I run away into the swamp, but I forgot my guide. And I stepped into some quicksand, and no matter how I tried, I couldn't get out until I met a crocodile named Clyde, who took me to some cannibals who planned to have me fried. They built a fire under me, and I swear I almost cried. Till an eagle come and swooped me up, and through the air we fly. But he dropped me in a boiling lake 1,000 miles wide. And you know what happened then? I died.
Speaking of legends and tall tales, there's a big one going around about the guy that writes a few songs and grabs his guitar and jumps on a bus and goes to Nashville and overnight becomes a smash. Now, friends, this works for some of the guys sometimes, but there's a whole lot of guys running up and down 16th Avenue South here, and you can see them at Tootsie's and you can see them at the Country Corner.
And these boys have a whole lot of dreams, same way I had mine. But sometimes they come true, sometimes they don't. I was hanging around Nashville writing songs and playing them for all of the stars, watching them laugh and hand them back, living on hope and Hershey bars. So I pawned my guitar and bought a ticket home, and I was heading for the trailway bus when I seen an old fountain pen laying in the gutter, so I stopped and picked it up. It was worn out, bent, and cast aside, kinda sorta like myself. So I sat down on the curb and wrote a little song. It told the world how both of us felt. Then I run that song down the music row, and before I had time to spit, it's pitched and sold and cut for a record and moving up the charts, and damn, it's a hit. So I wrote me another winner, then I wrote me a smash again, and I was a-flying off the ground, cause I knew I'd found me a sure-hit songwriter pen. So the songs, they just kept a-pouring out, and the money kept pouring in. I just couldn't miss. All it took was a twist of my sure-hit songwriter's pen. Remember when I won the Grammy? Then I won it again and again. Well, none of you knew it was all due to my sure-hit songwriter's pen. I was the darling of all of the ladies. I was a hero among the men, making big dough, working rodeos and TV shows, me and my sure-hit songwriter pen. But then one night in Wichita, I was just coming off of the stage. Folks all lined up screaming for my autograph. Lord, I was a national rage. One little freckle-faced girl was there. She said, "I got no pencil, sir." So I signed it with my songwriter pen and then handed the pen back to her. 4 o'clock that morning, I woke up with the shakes and the bends, with terror in my eyes, cause good God, I realized I'd lost my sure-hit songwriter pen. I offered rewards in the papers, and I pleaded on the sympathy line, and a whole lot of folks and a whole lot of pens, but none of them pens was mine. So my songs got worse and my money ran out, and so did all my good time friends. There was no doubt I was nothing without my long-lost, sure-hit songwriter pen. So I rolled like a stone down the old skid row, where I feed my blues on wine, and I rest my chops in a two-bit flop, and I tell my story for a drink or a dime, and I sleep with my shoes underneath my head and dream about days back then, when I blaze my name across the sky with my sure-hit songwriter pen. Somewhere in Wichita, some little girl who's a freckle-faced 9 or 10 is doing her arithmetic homework tonight with a sure-hit songwriter pen. I say, God bless you, honey. You got yourself a sure-hit songwriter pen there. Write a song for me, baby. You got a sure-hit songwriter pen. Send me some money. You got a sure-hit songwriter pen.
It's 2 in the morning on Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. The onions are frying, the neon is bright, and the jukebox is starting to play. And the sign on the wall says, "In God we trust, all others have to pay." And it's 2 in the morning on Saturday night
at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. The short order cook with the mama tattoo, he's a turning them hamburgers slow. Eggs over easy, whole wheat down. Do y'all want that coffee to go? He never once dreamed as a rodeo star that he'd wind up here today. At 2 in the morning on Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. There's a tall, skinny girl in the booth in the back, wearing jeans and a second-hand fur. She's been to the doctor, then called up a man, and now wonders just where she can turn. She stares at her coffee, then looks toward the ceiling. But Lord, it's a strange place to pray. At 2 in the morning on Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. There's a guy in a tux and he stands in the corner feeding the jukebox's dime. He just had a woman and thought that he'd bought her, but found he'd just rented some time. And he couldn't sleep, so he came back to see if anyone else wants to play. At 2 in the morning on Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. Now there's an old dollar bill in a frame on the wall, the first one that Rose ever made. It was once worth a dollar a long time ago, but like Rose, it's beginning to fade. She's back of the register, dreaming of someone and how things would be if he'd stayed. But it's 2 in the morning on Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. The stoop-shouldered man, his frizzy-haired woman, it's strange how their eyes never meet. He's playing the pinball, she's fixing the blanket of the baby asleep on the seat. He's out of work, she's putting on weight. Hell, they never did have too much to say. It's 2 in the morning, Saturday night, at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. The waitress, darling, she sits at the counter, painting her fingernails blue. And the short order cook, he yells, move it or lose it, and pick up an order stew. But someday a rich, handsome man will walk in and carry her far, far away. From 2 in the morning on Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats.
McCaffrey. The shaggy-haired hippie, he's finished his meal and he's counting the change in his jeans. Burger and coffee are 85 cents and he's only got 23. But he smiles at Rose, she winks back at him. But Lord, that's a high price to pay. At 2 in the morning on Saturday night at Rosalie's Good Eats Cafe. The baby-faced sailor, he leans on the phone and dials the number again, while the guy in the tux tells the girl in the jeans about the wonderful places he's been. And the wino comes in off the street and starts shouting about fortunes that he threw away. And Rosalie is asking the shaggy-haired hippie if he's got a warm place to stay. And the short order cook takes a fire from the till while Rosalie's looking away. And the onions keep frying, the neon is bright, and the jukebox continues to play. And it's 2 in the morning